Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
God's mercy endures forever.
Almighty God, to all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty Father, whose dear Son, on the night before he suffered, instituted the sacrament of his body and blood, mercifully grant that we may receive it thankfully in remembrance of Jesus Christ our Lord, who in these holy mysteries gives us a pledge of eternal life, and who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. Where I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that he was tied around his waist. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. You are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, he put on his robe and returned to the table. He said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you should also do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Our focus this evening is on a meal, a supper shared by 13 people, friends who had spent every day of the last three or so years together, have gathered to eat dinner. Even though the disciples probably did not realize it, Jesus knew that it was his final meal with them. In their last hours before everything changed, after what had probably been thousands of suppers before, these friends are breaking bread together one more time. All four Gospels tell about this supper on the night before Jesus was crucified. But the writers do not tell the same stories about this meal. They disagree about the meal's significance and about its timing in relationship to Passover. For the writers of the Synoptic Gospels, that is Matthew, Mark, and Luke, this final meal occurs on Passover and is when Jesus instituted the Eucharist. We heard echoes of that version of the story in the lesson from 1 Corinthians that was read just a few minutes ago. But in John's Gospel, which is what we just heard, this final meal happens just before Passover begins. and there is no mention of the bread and wine at all. Instead, John tells us of a different event. He tells us that during supper, Jesus got up, took off his outer robe, tied a towel around his waist, and began to wash the feet of his disciples. Needing to wash feet was not unusual in that time and space. Feet got dirty pretty quickly due to the dry and dusty roads of the towns and villages in ancient Palestine. Foot washing was customary and was an expected feature of good hospitality. In a modest home, the guests would wash their own feet with water provided by the host, while in a wealthier household, the host would provide a servant to wash those feet of his guests. For this was a demeaning job, as was any other task that involved other people's feet. No respectable member of society would wash another person's feet. Even among the servants, there was a hierarchy among who would wash. A Jewish slave, for example, would be excused from this task if a Gentile slave was available. And in that male-dominated society, women washed feet more often than male servants. Thus, the disciples were astonished when Jesus knelt down to wash their feet. Jesus, their teacher and master, performed this demeaning task for them. This is what Peter reacted to. It wasn't the washing that Peter was surprised but by who performed that washing. The one who was his Lord was the one washing his feet. It was a complete reversal of what he expected. I'd imagine the other disciples were similarly shocked, even though it's only Peter's response that got put into the narrative. And then, after washing their feet and having returned to the table, Jesus explains his action and gives them the new commandment, the commandment we heard at the end of the gospel passage, the commandment after which today is named. For, as you might know, Maundy comes from the Latin word mandatum, which means commandment. Today is named after the commandment to love one another just as Jesus has loved us. So what does it mean to love in this way? What does Jesus teach us about love through this action of washing his disciples' feet? For one, Jesus demonstrates that the kind of love he is demanding of us requires humility. By undertaking this most menial of acts, by turning the tables on expectation, Jesus shows us the upside-down nature of the Christian life, where power and hierarchy are not as they are in the world, where the first are last and the last are first. Jesus also demonstrates here that the kind of love he requires is offered to all. It is given even to those we might not especially like or get along with. And it is given without expectation of return. Now, we can't tell this from the part of the gospel we heard just now, but Judas was present for this part of the supper. It's in the section that immediately follows what was read today that John tells us about Satan entering Judas and Judas going out from the supper to notify the authorities about where to find Jesus. Thus, Jesus washed Judas's feet when he washed those of the other disciples. And he washed his feet even though he knew that Judas was the one about to betray him. Finally, Jesus' example shows us that love is not a feeling, but an action. The love that Jesus talks about means that we do for others. It is a choice of heart. And it is our love, our service, our actions that will show others that we follow Jesus, that we are his disciples. Today, we remember Jesus' commandment telling us to love one another as he has loved us. We remember the actions he performed to show us that love, not only those from the Last Supper, the foot washing, the institution of the Eucharist that we remember specifically today, but those done throughout his life, including his suffering on the cross. I'd like to end with some lyrics from a Ghanaian folk song that was translated into English by Thomas Colvin. I think it expresses our desire to love in the way that Jesus tells us to love, in the way that he loves us. You can find it in our hymnal, if you want to look later, in number 602. Jesu, fill us with your love. Show us how to serve the neighbors we have from you. Kneels at the feet of his friends, silently washes their feet, master who acts as a slave to them. Loving puts us on our knees, serving as though we were slaves. This is the way we should live with you. Jesu, fill us with your love. Show us how to serve the neighbors we have from you. So may it be.
Let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray to the Lord, saying, hear our prayer. We pray for the church, that as we break the bread and share the cup, we may be one in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks that Jesus loved his disciples to the end, and we pray for the grace to keep his new commandment of love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the nations and people of the earth, that there may be deliverance from oppression and terror, and an end to the shedding of innocent blood. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray that the one who was servant of all will move us to follow his example and serve those in need in this community and the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the weary, the betrayed, the sick, the suffering, and the dying, that Christ's presence may strengthen and restore them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who have died. They may feast forever at the table in God's heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And also with you. Good evening. Welcome to Calvary Church on this Maundy Thursday. You'll see towards the end of the bulletin the times of services for Good Friday, on Saturday the Great Easter Vigil, and then our three normal Sunday morning services on Easter Sunday at 8, 9, and 11. This service is a little different than normal. It's been the usual so far, but later on you will see at the end that we strip the altar, that is, we remove all the beautiful things or cover those we don't remove, and that is in preparation for Good Friday, tomorrow, the day we observe that Jesus died on the hill at Calvary. Golgotha's Aramaic, Calvary is Latin. So everything is removed, and then we reserve the sacrament, the bread and wine, and we will take it. You'll see me and Cameron process to the All Saints Chapel and reserve the sacrament there. So when we receive tomorrow for Good Friday, we don't celebrate the Eucharist, but we receive from that and then consume everything as a symbol that Jesus has died and in the tomb. And then for Easter is that first celebration of the resurrection. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For our sins he was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself. And by his suffering and death, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
Thank you.
the gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.